And to our internet guests, we're going to keep reminding you, if you haven't already, go down and subscribe to this cast so that when we come up, you'll be notified. That way you won't miss us. And also, we want you to share with your family, your friends, and your Sunday school classes that we're here, so they too can join in and be blessed by this powerful, mighty word of God here at World Class Sunday School. Somebody tell me what's wrong with the people today. Somebody tell me what's wrong with the people today. Seems like the brother of love faded away. We welcome you to World Class Sunday School. As always, it's a pleasure to have you join us as we continue to read and study God's Word. Let us go in prayer. Lord, again, we are thankful for this time to share in your Word, to sit at your feet, to learn more about you, so we can love you more and serve you better. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks and praises always. Amen. And we are continuing in our fall quarter, talking about celebrating God. And here in Unit 1 is entitled God's People Offer Praise. And so far this quarter, we've offered God praises through music. We've offered him praise in dance. And we've offered him praise by experiencing and following, expecting and following. And we've offered him praise for salvation. But today, we're going to praise God with joy. We're going to praise him with joy. And our lesson is coming from the 100th Psalm. This particular psalm, 100th Psalm, is a song of praise. And we know that David was the author of most of Psalms, but this one, this particular psalm, the author is unknown, but we still have enough here to praise God with joy. This psalm is calling God's people to praise him and also gives the reason why we should praise him. We have three outlines that we're going to follow in today's lesson. The first one is a call to all. Psalms 100, verses 1 and 2. The second outline is a call to know. And that's verse 3 in Psalms 100. And then the third outline is a call to thanksgiving. And that's now 100 Psalms, verses 4 and 5. This is just a beautiful scripture. I want to just read. It's short. It's only 5 verses. So I just want to read the entire Psalms, 100 Psalms, and then we'll come back and expound on it. 100 Psalms says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pastures. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations." Beautiful, just a beautiful, beautiful psalm. So we're going to just come back and start here in our first outline, and we're going to talk about a call to all. Verse 1 says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land." And here the psalmist is telling us to come with joy. It's a call to uninhibited praise with noise. It said, make a joyful noise. And this noise here in verse 1 is translated shout. And so what he's saying, shout, that's audible. And he's calling for a audible excitement when we come to God. These shouts can be accompanied by singing. It can be accompanied by hand clapping. It can be accompanied by musical instruments. But when we come to God, and what the psalmist is showing us and telling us, that when we come to God, we can come uninhibited, giving him the praise and the glory that he so richly deserved. It says, all ye land. Now here, all ye land, you know, the prophecy had been revealed that Jesus, as priest and king, had flung open the gates of the city to all mankind. The veil of partition had been broken down in the church. The courts of the sanctuary is open to all people on earth. Now anyone could come, Jews, Gentiles, Greeks, or barbarians, bond or free, irregardless, all, Jesus Christ made it possible for all to come to God. When Jesus Christ died on the cross, the veil in the temple that separated that the high priest would go and offer sacrifices to God for the covering of the sins of the nation had been rent from top to bottom, and now we can come to God uninhibited because of what Jesus Christ has done, and he's made this available to all mankind, regardless of if they were Jews or Gentiles. And Jews separated themselves from other nations, and they were God's chosen people. And we know the scripture teaches us that the gospel was first offered to the Jews, but then when they rejected it, it was offered to all. And so now the call that's going out here that we see in 100 Psalms verses 1 and 2 is a call to all. And then verse 2, it says, come with gladness. It says, verse 2 says, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Our worship leads to service. It says, serve the Lord with gladness. Our worship leads to service. And our service to God is accompanied with gladness. Serve the Lord with gladness. And paraphrasing Psalm 68:3 says, let the righteous be glad before God with exceedingly joy. And we are made righteous by the blood of Christ. And because it wasn't nothing that we did, because we are all sinners and we have all come short of God's glory. But because of the sacrifice of Christ, the shedding of his blood, and when we accept that, then righteousness is imputed to us. And now, because we are righteous, the psalmist said, let us come gladly before God with exceedingly joy. So we can come to him with singing because we have been made righteous by the blood of Christ. We should not serve God. Our service to God should not be ho-hum or burdensome. This was the plight of Israel in Egypt when they served the taskmasters in Egypt. But God brought them out as he has brought us out. He's brought us out from under sin. Now we can serve him with exceedingly joy, because now there's no hindrance. There's nothing. We have been put back in the right relationship with God because we have been made righteous by the blood of Christ, and our sins have been forgiven. And because of that, then we can serve God with exceedingly joy, and because of how Christ has brought us back into the right fellowship with him. See, we can come with gladness, serve. We can serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with singing. And we all should have a song on our heart, praising and thanking God for what he has done for us. Okay, and so it brings us to the second portion of our lesson. The second outline here, we talking about a call to know. At first, it was a call to come, a call to all to come. We come with thanksgiving and praises, making a joyful noise, praising him audibly, praising him with hand claps of praise, with singing, with musical instruments. And we've come with an attitude of gladness because of how God has brought us out. And now the call is to know. That's verse 3. Verse 3 says, "Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture." Here in verse 3 of Psalm 100, the call to know. The call to know who God is and who we are. The knowledge of God is the mother of devotion and all obedience. Knowing him on a personal level, we're talking about not just having a head knowledge of God. The Bible tells us that even Satan know God and tremble. But here, to this knowledge of God, we're talking about having a personal relationship with God. And the beginning of wisdom is knowing God. And when we talk about knowing God, we know that God is good. The word of God tells us that he is good. And he is infinitely perfect. He is self-existent. God doesn't need aid from anything or anyone, because he is the self-existent one. He is self-sufficient. He has all he needs. And God, we know that God just spoke and everything that is came into existence. And so God is self-efficient. He is an eternal spirit. God has always been, and God will always be. He is incomprehensible. There are things that we just can't understand about God, because his thoughts are high above our thoughts and his ways are high above our ways. And he is our creator. God is our creator. The B part of verse 3 says, "It is he that has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture." God is our creator. There was no way we could create ourselves. God did it. He is both the former of our bodies, and he is the father of our spirit. God formed man from the dust of the ground, and blew into his nostrils, man became a living soul. And now that that Christ has sacrificed his life on the cross and promised God's Spirit that will live in us, we now have God's Spirit living in us because of the promise of God. And we are his. We belong to him. We are his. We are God's. And to him we belong. Because he created us, he formed us, he created us, we belong to him. That's who God is, and that's who we are as it relates to God. He is our sovereign ruler. God is our sovereign ruler, and he's given us the rules and the precepts and the laws that we should live by in his word. And God knows what's best for us. And when we live according to God's precepts, according to God's word, then it's going to be better for us. Because he's our sovereign ruler. And we are his people. He is our bountiful benefactor. When we need something, God has already invited us to come to him. And he will supply our every needs according to his riches and glory. He's our sole benefactor. And we are his sheep. And you know, the good shepherd takes care of his sheep. And when you look at the relationship between a shepherd and a sheep, you know, the sheep has no defense mechanism. So the shepherd has to protect him. A sheep really on his own does not know how to go out and get food. And so that the shepherd makes sure that the sheep is in a place where they can eat bountifully. And so the shepherd is responsible for the sheep's, not only for the sheep's protection, but also for the sheep's provision. And God has promised that he would take care of us. He would never leave us or forsake us. And he tells us not to worry about food or clothes, because he's going to make sure that we are provided for. And he said, God says, if I can feed the sparrows of the air, surely I can take care of my own. And he does that. So he's our bountiful benefactor, and we are his sheep, and he's our shepherd. That's who God is, and that's who we are related in relations to him. Okay, and the final outline that we see here today, we looked at a call. We looked at a call to all. How God has made a provision that all could come to him, and that there was no God has no respect of person, and we looked at how we should come to him with gladness because of how he's brought us out from under sin. Israel was celebrating the fact that he had brought them out of Egypt and provided for them through the wilderness experience and brought them into the promised land. And we can celebrate him because he's brought us from under sin, and he walks with us daily, and Christ has gone to prepare a place for us, and he's coming back to receive us. He says he's coming back to receive us unto himself, that where he is, there we may be also. And so that's why we can come to him with gladness. And then we are called to know him, to know all the attributes of God, and They're all in our favor. And now the third and final call is a call to thanksgiving. A call to thanksgiving. It says, verse 4 and 5 is what we're looking at here. In verse 4, it talks about being in God's presence. It says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. And then verse 5 talks about God's greatness. It says, for the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. And so here the call goes out to all, and then we're called to know him, and then a call to thanksgiving. And here in verse 4, when we talk about God's presence, those who entered, and referring back to Israel, those who entered the temple would bring appropriate offerings. When we enter God's presence, our appropriate offerings are thanksgiving and praises. Because it's a blessing for us to even be admitted before God. Because sin had separated us from God. God had no relationship with us because of our sin. And because he loved us so, he gave his only son, Jesus Christ, who came and willingly gave his life, paying our sin debt. Because, you know, the wages of sin was death. But God gave us the gift of everlasting life when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So his only son's blood, he sacrificed his blood, paying our sin debt. Now that we are back in the right relationship with God, we can enter into his presence. Because before that, we could not enter into God's presence because God would not associate with sin. But now that we have been cleansed from our sins, we've been forgiven of our sins by the blood of Christ, now we can enter into God's presence with thanksgiving. And when we enter into his presence, then our appropriate offering should be thanksgiving and praise. Because what? It's a privilege. It's a blessing. It's a gift that God has given us to be back in the right fellowship with him so that we could go to him on a personal basis. Israel could only, they went to the temple once a year, and the high priest would have to cleanse themselves in order to go into the holies of holies and make the sacrifice so that Israel's sin would be covered until the next time. But Christ has made it possible that we can come to God anytime and ask for forgiveness of our sins. And in fact, 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so because of what Christ has done, we can go into God's presence. And when we talk about God's presence, that's communing with God, fellowshipping with God. And we can do that because of what Christ has done for us. And so we can come into his gates with thanksgiving and to his courts with praise and be thankful to him and bless his name. For God, the Lord is good and his mercy is everlasting. We do thank and praise him for his goodness, his mercy, and his truth. God's mercy is greater than all our sins. That's why he gave his only son. And he won't take it back. He said before he take it back, he'll add more blessings to it. His mercy is new every day. Great is his faithfulness. And we experience the same goodness from God that Israel enjoyed. It says, and his truth endured to all generations. And we experience the same goodness from the Lord, from the Lord's hand that Israel had received. But we rejoice knowing that we belong to God, and we thank him and we give him praises and adorations because of who he is and what he's done for us. And we can look back on Israel's history and see how God protected them and brought them through. But not only that, we can look back in our own lives and see how God has protected us and brought us through. When God makes a promise that he will never leave us or forsake us, and that he will provide our every needs, God is going to make sure that promise is carried out, because all his promises are yea and amen. So let's give God a rousing round of praise. And praise and make a joyful noise when we come into his presence for all the things that he has done. We can praise him and thank him and make a joyful noise because of his goodness and his grace and his mercy toward us. Lord, we thank you for this time. Thank you for your word that just fills our heart with joy to know that you love us so much. And we love you because you first loved us. We thank you, Lord. We praise you. We magnify you. We know we belong to you. And we thank you and praise you for all that you have done. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks and praises always. Well, again, friends, we thank you for joining us on today, and we look forward to having you in our next session. So until then, may God richly bless and keep you, is our prayer.